Yo, Adam Saxon with Gaina Cube, and in this video, I want to look at my thought process or the steps that I take when I'm trying to improve performance on my Power BI reports or on your Power BI reports. Let's do this. If you're finding us for the first time, be sure to hit that subscribe button to stay up to date with all the videos from both Patrick and myself. All right, did a video not too long ago about the tools that both Patrick and I use when we're working with Power BI, whether that's troubleshooting, just learning more about Power BI, you name it. In this video, what I really want to dig in on is how I use those tools on a day-to-day basis. So specifically, someone calls me up and says, hey, my report is slow or Power BI is slow. These are the steps I'm going to take. There is a methodology to this. I know Patrick does the same thing because we work on a lot of this stuff together just to learn from each other in terms of what we're doing. All right, enough of all this talking. You know how we like to do it here on Gaina Cube. Let's do what? Let's head over to my machine. All right, I've got a Power BI report here. A lot of times when I'm actually working with customers, I don't actually have their Power BI desktop file. Sometimes I can do a screen share, but what I will ask for first are a couple of things. I talked about this in the tools video. The first thing is VertiPack Analyzer. What I'm gonna do here is just go ahead and run that from Power BI desktop. So I'm gonna go to external tools and I'm gonna go and launch DAX Studio. I already have DAX Studio installed. What I'm just gonna do is go to the advanced tab and I'm gonna hit view metrics. This will get me my VertiPack Analyzer metrics, which we can see down below. This will give me the statistics for the actual items that are in my Power BI desktop file, right? So my tables, my cardinality, all of these things. This is one of the first things that I do and I look at because I just want to get a feel for what this model is. Yes, I know you have performance issues. My gut internally tells me I'm going to hit a few things that are just a common thing I see across models from a performance perspective. So let's look at what those are. First thing I zero in on is the cardinality column. What I want to do is go after the biggest item because that's probably going to have the most bang for the buck. It's going to give me the biggest mileage in terms of improvements. And so right now we can see sales and opportunities have the largest cardinality. The other thing this tells me is those are probably my fact tables. If we think about a star schema, because those are usually have the highest cardinality because it's got the most number of rows in that table. So at the table level, you can think of cardinality as these are the number of actual rows in that table, which is 25 million. Other things we can look at here that are important is we can see the size information. So how much space is this even taking up? And we can see that the sales and opportunity tables are both basically taking up 33 to 34% of the entire model. That's huge, right? So these are the biggest things. And then if I go to the summary tab, we can see the total size of this model is about 884 meg. So this is in memory, that's not on disk. And we can also see some other information, like we've got 23 tables, we've got 263 columns, so on and so forth. If you wanna get this to send to someone else, you can just do export metrics. That'll save out a VPax file that you could then send to someone that wants to look at your, you know, optimize your model. So it's a great thing to have. So let's dig into sales a little bit more. What I do here is I look at a couple of things here, right? So again, I'm gonna look at cardinality, which one has the highest cardinality? And we can see that it's sales order number. The minute I see this sales order number, I'm thinking a few things. Without looking at anything else, ignore the right side of this table. I see high cardinality and I see sales order number and I immediately think, string. It's probably a string. And sure enough, if we look over, yes, it is a string. This is just some value that's on this table that's referencing the actual order number. It's not an integer because it probably has a letter in front of it or some format of some kind. This is killing the fact table. This is 15% of the entire table. Do I need this column? Am I actually reporting on it? Is it important in the visuals that I do? In this case, maybe not. Remove it. I haven't even looked at the report. I'm just looking at the statistics for the model itself, right? And I'm thinking in my head, what are these recommendations I can make to optimize the model and to get better performance? Is removing this from a data model gonna actually improve the speed of my visuals? Maybe, maybe not. But these are also best practices that we can follow, right? So remove columns if you don't use them in your model, right? This frees up space. This could potentially help with the compression of the tables. It could also improve refresh times. So there's a lot of benefits that you can get, even if it doesn't necessarily affect the performance visuals. Although a lot of times if they're really bad and, you know, your model's kind of janky, it'll end up helping your visual performance too. A couple other things I look at here is I look at the size information, right? So data compared to dictionary compared to hierarchy size, these three together equal the column size. So one other thing that we can see, because sales order number, it's a string, there's a lot of cardinality here. We have hash encoding because it is a string, which means we have a dictionary. This dictionary is massively bigger than the actual data. So another reason just to get rid of this column if we don't need it. We'll come back to hierarchy size when we look at another tool, but hierarchy size is something to consider. Do we need the hierarchy on a fact table? A lot of times, probably not. Like a relationship key, like product key, we don't need the hierarchy here. We're not going to be using this in Excel or for sales amount or total cost or anything like that. These are items where we're going to wrap it in a measure, and the measure will be used from an Excel perspective if we need it, or even in our visuals. So just be aware of that, that this is a potential option to free up and optimize space. Another thing we can see here is this local date table, all of these local date tables. That means auto date time. So we can disable potentially auto date time if we've got a central calendar table to just free these out of the model. Again, reducing space, reducing processing time. A lot of times though, they're gonna be really small and you don't really care about them. But in this case, we have one that is actually pretty big and it's taking up 29% of the model space, which is huge. By disabling auto date time, we can get rid of that. Go check out the video I did on one checkbox. So, and that goes into more details about the auto date time and what this specific scenario is, if you're interested. So those are just some things I go through from a VertiPack analyzer perspective, right? I'm looking at cardinality. I'm looking at the data options. I'm looking at the encoding that's being used on the columns. I'm looking at the data types. These are all things I consider in terms of what can I potentially make recommendations on in the model for changes to optimize both space, performance, all of those things. After I've kind of gone through that and I've categorized my thoughts, I've kind of jotted some notes down, I've got some initial recommendations, the next thing I do is I head over to Tabular Editor. Tabular Editor is another external tool, so I'm just gonna go and launch that. And what I'm gonna do here on this model is I'm going to get my BPA rules set up here. I know people are screaming at me for not having this auto set up, but you know, that's the way I roll. So we've got those rules, and I'll have a link down below if you wanna go grab those rules from Michael Kowalski. It's out on the Power BI blog. We're gonna go run those rules. And so we're gonna see a bunch of items here that we can do. Now, right away from a perf perspective, I don't care about formatting. One thing down here though that you'll see is 512 objects in violation of 27 best practice rules. So 512. I've seen some where it's like 3000 or 5000. I'm just gonna remove formatting because I just don't care about them from a performance perspective. Couple things that stand out to me, remove unnecessary columns. Unnecessary columns may or may not be needed. This is kind of the thing with these rules is you kind of got to make some judgment calls. And some of it is you need to know the data. So removing unnecessary columns, you may actually need them, right? So you need to understand your data and know whether or not this is a valid item, right? So the rules just calling it out as a potential item, and then you need to validate that. So reduce usage of calculated tables. Some people get surprised by this, but again, we're gonna see all those local date tables. This is the auto date time. And we've got some other calculated tables that are in the model as well. Remove auto date tables. Again, that's just redundant on what we're doing. So set is available in MDX. So this is gonna give you recommendations for columns that you can set is available in MDX to false. This goes back to the hierarchy column that I showed in the VertiPack analyzer. So if we set is available in MDX to false in the model for the columns, then that hierarchy size goes away. The thing to be aware of here is it's not supported to do that against Power BI Desktop directly. So you'd have to publish the model and then modify that from an XMLA endpoint perspective. So is available in MDX is definitely a recommendation that I look for. Do not use floating point data types. This is another thing that I look for. Like, can we set that to just a straight integer? That could potentially switch it over to using value encoding instead of hash encoding. Again, freeing up the dictionary, space and processing time needed for those columns, helping with compression, all of those things. And then some other DAX things here, right? So avoid using if error function in your measures. Every time I've seen that come up from a BPA rule perspective, they're doing division inside of those items. There are reasons why you may want to use divide versus just a straight, you know, slash. And that's all around, are you checking for divide by zero. So this may flag something where you're like, well, no, actually I'm doing this for a specific reason. But again, it comes down to the performance, right? What performs better? The other cool thing here is I can just say, oh, go to the object. What is it? Oh, hey, look at that. If error, I'm doing a division. I knew it. So these are all things that I can look at from the model perspective. And again, I'm jotting notes down. I'm making recommendations on what we can do. So now I've got a feel for this. Now, sometimes what I'll do if I don't have the Power BI desktop file, then I go back to the customer and I'm like, all right, can you show me some things? Or if I have the Power BI desktop file, I'm going to do this anyway. Let's go to view. And then I'm going to go to performance analyzer. And then I just want to see, show me what you're experiencing from a slowness perspective. If it's slow in Power BI desktop, don't publish it to the service and just expect it to be insane amazing. So make sure that it's fast in Power BI desktop before it goes to the service. If you can, you can't always in every circumstance, especially if you're working with massive data. So let's start recording. We're gonna go over to our blazing fast report, and then we're gonna see it's a little sluggish, right? We're gonna, you know, really, really big matrix, and I can expand that and immediately see, okay, DAX is my problem here. I can go optimize that. And then we can expect other visuals as well. And then from there, it's just an exercise of optimizing these visuals and optimizing the DAX performance once we've got the model shored up. So I can copy that query. I can head back over to Power BI desktop. That's my query from the visual. And then what I'm gonna do here is I'm gonna turn on server timings. I'm gonna do clear cache and run. So I clear the data cache and then actually see what's going on. I'm gonna see the performance information, and then I can go through and further optimize my model and optimize the DAX. And then it's just a DAX exercise, which I'm not going to go through all of that in this video. It's already long enough. Other things that I look for here, I was just on a customer call. They had a direct query model and they're like, wow, our reports are slow. If they say their reports are slow, my first thought is, are we using direct query? Because usually direct query is going to be slow because you haven't modeled your direct query source in a way that is performant for Power BI. You're just throwing it against some transactional database and just expecting it to work. And so again, I'm gonna look at Performance Analyzer, and we can see here, oh my gosh, look, Power BI is so slow. This table took 11 and a half seconds just to render. Look, there's not a lot of data there. Why did it take so long? Let's expand that. Oh, direct query was the problem. That is your data source. So these tools can help you pinpoint like where those problems are, give you pointer directions of where to go look and where to go optimize. And these are all things that I do when I go through. That's my methodology. All right, hopefully that checklist of VertiPack Analyzer, your BIM or model information and tabular editor, Performance Analyzer, and then just going through and optimizing those items, figuring out what those best practices are. Hopefully that helps you in your journey in Power BI performance. Let me know in the comments below, what do you do when you're actually trying to troubleshoot performance, or what's your thought process on? What tools do you use to get the most mileage? If you like this video, be sure to hit that big thumbs up button. Smash it if you so desire. If it's your first time here, hit that subscribe button. And as always, from both Patrick and myself, thank you so much for watching. Keep being awesome, and we'll see you in the next video.